Tonight, Biden and Trump agree. Both are slamming Republican efforts to link Social Security and Medicare reforms to the vote to raise the nation's debt ceiling, a debt ceiling that the United States, of course, reached yesterday. And Trump spoke out with a clear warning today.
Under no circumstances should Republicans vote to cut a single penny from Medicare or Social Security. Save Social Security. Don't destroy it.
And the White House saying, and I quote, House Republicans should think very hard before they spend months telling the American people that they want to reverse the best unemployment rate in 50 years in order to slash Medicare and Social Security. Now, of course, all of this is referring to Republicans insisting on spending cuts and efforts to link Social Security and Medicare reforms to raising the debt ceiling. Out front now, Mick Mulvaney, the former OMB director for President Trump, who also was in Congress in 2011 when the debt ceiling debate led to the country's top-notch credit rating being downgraded, and we've never gotten it back. And Karen Finney, the former DNC communications director. So, Mick, let me start with you. Should Republicans, in this case, listen to Trump on this and stay away from Social Security and Medicare?
Yeah, Aaron, it's great to be here and have that introduction. We actually had our debt lowered because we didn't have a way to pay off the debt, but that argument is 10 years old now. So let's talk about what's happening now. Look, Social Security and Medicare are a lot of different things. What I think Trump was saying is the same thing he said to me when I was in his budget office, which is don't touch old age retirement and don't touch mainline Medicare. But Social Security and Medicare are a lot more than that. Social Security has disability components that I don't think people know they pay into. Medicare pays for a lot of doctors' trainings and education for folks in the healthcare area that they didn't think that's what their Medicare
is. So you agree with the GOP who want to link them. I mean, are you going that far? As long as it doesn't do payments, you're going to these disability or whatever. You agree with that or no?
Yeah, and I think you can solve it. You can do both things that Trump just said. What he said was don't cut it, save it. And look, back in the 1980s, the last time we saved Social Security, we made changes that didn't kick in on people until 30 years later. You can fix Social Security without cutting benefits to anybody who's getting it today or anyone who's anywhere near retirement. It's difficult to have those discussions because it's so easy to demagogue this issue. I know the Democrats are doing to the Republicans, and to a certain extent, Trump did it to them today as well.
He certainly did. Now, Karen, this comes, though, as the Republicans are saying that they want these, they're calling them reforms. Mm-hmm. The White House is saying they are not going to negotiate at all. President Biden does plan to meet with the House Speaker McCarthy and other congressional leaders, but he says raising the debt ceiling is not negotiable, absolutely not negotiable. But it's interesting because that doesn't go always with the narrative he's given. Here he is when he was a candidate. I did a 2019 town hall with him. Here's what he said.
We got a lot done by pure compromise. Remember, every time we got in trouble and couldn't get something passed in the House or the Senate, who got sent up to the Hill? I even convinced the Republicans to increase taxes on the wealthy for the first time ever by $600 billion on New Year's Eve Day when we were about to go under in terms of reneging on a national debt. This is something I've done. I can do it again.
So his whole point was, I negotiate. And on this, absolutely non-negotiable. Is he wrong to rule out a negotiation now?
No, he's 100% right. Two things. Number one, he was referring to the last time that Republicans put us on, played brinksmanship. And we know that there was a lot of fiscal pain, economic pain, in the aftermath of 2011 and 2013. Number two, he learned a lesson that apparently McCarthy has not. If you give this MAGA extremist wing of the Republican Party an inch, they will take 15 rounds to make a decision. So I think, and actually I talked to a friend some folks on Wall Street today. They actually prefer that the president is taking a strong stance, trying to head off sort of what we've seen in the past with this brinksmanship.
And Mick, to this point, when you, of course, were in the White House, you were the OMB director for President Trump in 2019, debt ceiling comes around, you all wanted to raise it. Here's what he said then about the debt ceiling.
I can't imagine anybody ever even thinking of using the debt ceiling as a negotiating wedge. That's a very, very sacred thing in our country, debt ceiling. We can never play with it.
Mikinosi said, I can't imagine anybody thinking of using it as a negotiating wager. A few weeks later, you announced that you and Trump's advisors all agreed that a debt ceiling hike should not be tied to any other policy proposals. You wanted a clean debt ceiling raise. Yet this time I saw that you tweeted that you support the House Republicans who are insisting on spending cuts in exchange for a debt ceiling deal. What's changed? Why are you okay with it this time?
Well, I do. I think that if you've got a situation like you have now, where the Republicans are in charge of the House and the Democrats are in charge of the Senate and the White House, doesn't it just make sense that there would be some sort of compromise? Yes, if all three, if one party's in charge of all branches of government, like the Democrats have been for the last couple of years, or were under Barack Obama, or we were during the early days of Trump, it's not surprising that they don't reach out to the other party. Under these circumstances, with a divided government, I don't understand why there isn't more discussion. And to the MAGA wing of the party.
So your issue you're saying the issue you have it now is, I just want to make sure I'm understanding what you're saying, is you're saying that this is about politics. That when there's divided, that you're fine with the negotiation, but not when it's all one party. So it's not actually about the debt ceiling being sacred and debt being sacred.
That's how Washington works, Aaron. I mean, that's how it worked for the last 2 years. No one seemed to complain about it. That's just how Washington has always worked. Look, you've got a situation here where you can do something like Barack Obama did back in 2011, and I think it was 13 as well, where he gave a little bit, the Democrats got a lot, and we increased the debt ceiling. Why doesn't that model work here? Why isn't it just as unreasonable to say you're not going to do anything, like the Democrats are saying, as the Republicans have said they want everything? Keep in mind, it's not the MAGA wing of the party. Don Bacon is a member of the Problem Solvers Caucus. Brian Fitzpatrick is a centrist. They're the ones who are saying that the Democrats should get a little bit and the Republicans should get a little bit. So this narrative to blame it on the extreme right, I think, is just distracting from what's actually happening.
Karen.
Washington wants to get a compromise, and
but
I think they will ultimately on this.
Karen?
Two things. Number one, that is not what the American people told us in the election. And I think we need to remember, we are just coming out of a global pandemic that wrecked the global economy. We're just starting to see gas prices go down. We're just starting to see inflation go down. So the economic anxiety that people have is very real. And the idea that Republicans in Congress, you know, this tends to happen every time there's a Democratic president, Republicans find religion on the debt ceiling. And yet, the first bill that they passed, let's call it out, by taking back the funds for the IRS, that is going to add billion dollars to the national deficit. So for them to say that this is a principled conversation about debt is just ludicrous. This is about politics and having a Democratic president. It is not about principle.
Right, and we should note, of course, when it comes to piling debt on, talk about being bipartisan. There's nothing more bipartisan than borrowing money to spend it in Washington. Thank you both very much. I appreciate your